Thanks to John Haymaker and the Design Space Inspector.
Hi, everybody. Thanks to Perkins+Will for inviting me. Great. Just a quick introduction of myself. Up until 3 years ago, I was a professor at Georgia Tech, teaching computational design and decision making, and joined Perkins+Will about 3 years ago as a director of research. What I'm going to be presenting today is, something that's a little bit on the border of research and practice and exploration about that transition. Working on a parallel coordinates plot. So this is a slide I showed internally to our firm of 2,000 owners and 26 offices. And I think the last presentation was a great example of that. Wow, what a transformation we did about how we're designing. I also started with sketch and all kinds of amazing things happening. With that great responsibility, I think we're now entering into a much more performance-driven, performance-based problems where our clients are expecting us to promise and deliver performance. We need to have to do the best we can do. And this is something I struggle with a lot. We have a lot of enablers, older designers, frankly, are producing things that we're not able to do. Optimization and things like that. So that was kind of a reflection point of understanding what design intuition can bring, what computation of how approaches can bring, and finding that sweet spot that enables this kind of sideboard design
What I'm going to talk about today is I'll first just give you a bit of an overview to research at Perkins+Will generally, and then drill into one specific piece of our research, which is around really leveraging design tools in the process. I'll argue that the way we're doing design exploration and decision making today is kind of structurally and formally unclear and unsystematic, and that it's eroding the potential value that we can promise and deliver to our clients. I'll introduce a model called the design space, and building information model with more concepts attached to it that helps us formalize this process and the hypothesis is if we adopt this model, we can design more systematically and clearly. I'll show you an example of what it looks like, and then I'll talk about some of my trials and tribulations. So at Perkins+Will, we've kind of organized ourselves into 9 research labs in the focus areas that kind of cut across our practice areas. And then we have a number of mechanisms that support us in innovation incubator that foster kind of ongoing small grants area research to approach nonprofit funding. We try to be very open with our work with our website, with our research at Perkins+Will.com and our research journal. And a lot of active effort in taking the results of this research and pushing it through learning and development into our various practices. So drilling in on one of these labs, process lab, we're kind of a diverse distributed group. We have folks in different offices who are mostly primarily practitioners, but who have a bit of a research bent, more interested in kind of meeting and advancing the practice, and also hopefully engaging with their local universities. So for example, our LA folks here are connected to Karen and Doug and all the great stuff that we do. So let's just jump into a 9 problem, hopefully a simple one we can just quickly wrap our head around. And I'll use this as a kind of muse to get some definitions across. So our challenge here, our performance-based design challenge, is to configure a really capable classroom to maximize value to the client. Vague so far, but we want to move up that value arrow and get as close to the top of the job. The value is this kind of triple bottom line, or front-end report stuff. Value is a function of experiential, ecological, and economic factors, experience, environmental quality, and teaching performance, quality, environment, the water, the habitat, the economy, the cost, the time, all that kind of stuff. So we want to be moving ourselves up these arrows as well. Better experience, better ecology, better economy. The value is maximized by generating alternatives. Generate a number of alternatives. In this case, in a relocatable classroom, we might have some decisions about the orientation, offset, the size of the windows, different configuration aspects of this kind of confined environment. We maximize this value by generating these alternatives and then systematically analyzing their performance, understanding how well they're performing in terms of business, ecology, and economy. And we measure that in terms of value. Values maximized by iterating, right? We don't create one design, we create many designs. We iterate, and we look for the balance of the various factors that we're looking for in order to find a design that maximizes value to the client. So it's more complex. Many of us work with multi-headed clients. And so we have to really understand this concept of value. It's maybe different to different stakeholders, and also need to understand and manage that. So I'll argue that what I've tried to do is kind of lay out a general design as decision-making definition. It's on this case design. And I'll argue that we don't do that very well. And I've kind of drawn everything up here dashed, that we don't systematically understand our client's value functions. We don't systematically define what we do. Economy, and we don't systematically understand and look through all of the potential alternatives for this type of performance. And so we're kind of leaking value onto every project, also we don't maximize value ever, but not being clear and systematic about what it means. So the goal is that we can systematically define these design spaces and search through them in a way that helps us constantly maximize finding value. So what is a design space? Is my voice coming in and out pretty annoying? Okay. So what is a design space? It's a model. And it's a model of a decision. You can kind of think about BIM as being a piece of this model, but we're going to add a bunch of concepts around it. Model of a decision, which includes the team that's involved in making this decision, an understanding of the stakeholders who are impacted by it, the decision makers who have the power to formulate the team and ultimately make a decision. It's the designers, the experts who can generate and analyze decisions. And it's gatekeepers who can put constraints possible. So just a sort of example to make this concrete. From our classroom example, it might look something like this. Design space is also a model of the objectives this decision is meant to achieve. It needs goals and priorities over those goals, and that includes constraints, things which absolutely have to be satisfied. So you have to meet the constraints, and then the goal, you can start to measure and trade off against in terms of making a decision. So again, things like access to daylight, minimizing energy consumption, getting down to metrics and units and preferences around all of these goals as much as you can be clear about. Design space is also a model of the alternatives the decision is trying to choose from. Most of our BIM tools today are really good at representing one alternative, or perhaps one alternative parameters, but it's not really the way in that alternative space so that you have almost systematic about that. There's a definition of the alternatives, the range of possibilities for the classroom example. The design space is also a model of the impacts of each of the alternatives on each of our media objectives. So this can involve needing to get into some details, process clarity about how are we going to build that model, how are we going to analyze that model, so who's going to do what, so we expand our process model a little bit to talk about how we're going to get that information. The design space includes the implementation of all of this stuff, so there's some of the grasshopper components for generating alternatives and analyzing the impacts, visualizing them. This space includes analysis of the energy impacts, daylight, the views. And then finally, design space includes the sort of synthesis of all of this information, these priorities overall, this analysis of all of these alternatives generated by all of these people into some sort of a value equation that allows you to weigh this information and make decisions. And ultimately, you end up with something that might look like this, a parallel coordinates plot that I built up earlier, describing the alternatives, we looked at the variables that led to those, the impacts on those, on the objectives based on those variables. And we start to drill in and using our value equation, just start to look at designs that have maximum value. You can see that some of the variables over here, for example, lower window lengths are being eliminated from the space as well as looking at designs that maximize value. And finally, we can start to drill in maximum value, and understand. These may vary quite a bit depending on how we weigh the different objectives, but we're just working in the space of promising designs. And then ultimately, you might want to go through a further qualitative evaluation using something like choosing by languages and qualitative factors as well. So that's a design space. Model of a kind of meta model of design that includes the formulation of the decision. So that's kind of coming from the theory side, and now I'm practice and wondering how we can start to bring this into practice and make it useful. And it starts to bring up a number of different new decision, new research questions for us. Things like, how do we really engage stakeholders and understand what the value is? How do we actually generate a good parametric model that gives us data? How do we analyze these for different quantitative criteria? How do we make and communicate these decisions with confidence? And ultimately, what's the cost and benefit? And I've got lots of busy people wanting to get on with design, motives and things like that. Is this going to lead to better design? Are we really going to be able to deliver better product to the client? Or is this just that? So to explore this, we've created something called the Design Space Construction Project. The website called designspaceconstruction.org. We're just trying to collect different cases and resources and things that we developed as we developed this inquiry. So what the Design Space Project is a kind of series of projects. Each project includes a number of participants, very focusing on a bunch of multidisciplinary questions that we're trying to address. So we try to bring into the same room the practitioners who really understand the problems in practice, what's going on, what needs to be solved. We try to bring in the researchers from the universities who are understand the points of departure of what's kind of really possible and out there already. They have the research methods to really help us ask and answer these questions. We bring in the professors who are often the researchers as well, but who can help us kind of orchestrate projects in a university setting and help us to ask and answer these questions. And then the kind of engine that makes it all work are the students. Kind of amazing, talented people who are willing to really dive in and do some hard work and try modeling things that people help us answer these questions. So each project kind of goes through, they're usually you know, perhaps it's a 2 or 3 day process or a semester long process. So we started off by issuing some kind of challenge, something from our projects. It's difficult. The team can get together and formulate challenges. The students, the researchers go about trying to address the issues and address the challenge. We learned from a number of different approaches to addressing the challenge and get lots of good data about different ways of approaching designing decision-making models. To support the process, we developed some curriculum that walks folks through the problem formulation, alternative analysis and decision-making example I showed you with the relocated classroom earlier. So this is all downloadable from the website with grasshopper scripts and tools that we can throw according to plot and things like that. And then we've been doing this kind of iteratively with a number of different collaborators, universities, mainly at Georgia Tech, but we're branching out now and looking for more and more collaborators. We see a number of different kind of challenge types across the top there, the types of projects that we've approached these projects with. And we present them with this tool set as well as a place to be started. But to give you an example of one project, this was at Georgia Tech in 2015. We approached them with the design of a cancer treatment facility, explained to them how in practice we went about programming and developing massings for the project. And then on the right-hand side is one part of the result where they developed a kind of more systematic process for generating, analyzing the programs and helping make decisions about their impact on massing. Out of the project came something called Space Plan Generator, which is an ongoing project that essentially, given a building program on the left-hand side, this program uses a number of different strategies for laying out different departments and then program within those departments in an automated way. And then the students started playing with creating attachments to those generative systems that would, for example, simulate what kind of structure you need and how much that might cost, or what's the view from the nurse's station to the different spaces that are available. Anthony Hawk would be happy with us. We've had two promotions of Fractal now, Project Fractal, something showed earlier. We're working with them in the development of the tool to understand how to design alternatives and the performance data and help make decisions with it. So that's one example of taking this idea of design space and introducing it to this project in the university, and in this case, some kind of new software, new approaches came out of that collaboration. The next example I'll talk about is up at the University of Washington. In Seattle, they have something called the Living Building Program, which is living building sort of about need as a collection of environmental requirements on the building. And then there's something called the Living Building Challenge, which is taking those requirements and making them a bunch more extreme, zero energy, zero loss requirements on the building. And then Seattle has adopted the Living Building Challenge, created a district and said, hey, if you build by these types of requirements, we'll give you extra square footage, we'll give you extra height. So we went with the developer and WSP Washington, and we created this challenge to look at this project, a project in downtown, and asked them to develop a process for really analyzing feasibility. And what we're really trying to explore here is, as we start to adopt this data-driven approach, what's the impact on so these are some of the results of the student work after a 10-week quarter, where they first started quite systematically analyzing things like an impact of orientation and moving along ratio, things like that, on energy and water and their air requirements. They ended up producing data sets like this. So this was one of the student solutions, found that kind of unique combination of office and residential program strategically positioned around the forum, depending on when people are using it, allowed her to get closer to the insights that she achieved out of there. So I won't read the, these are different kind of participants that were involved in this particular project. I think there were a lot of co-founders that were trying to find find new ways to think about approach performance based environments. So I'm currently, I've done this and used the university as a place for great ideas and motivation, but also able to use these student projects and student teams to practice these methods and provide demonstrations for all of them. For some of that is to position our design teams to be able to more formal ask and answer design questions in a way that promoting kind of actively involved in our the office and teach workshops and try to work with project teams to understand the methods and introduce them to the clients, bring them along with that journey. A really important kind of piece of this, I find, is process clarity. Being able to bring a team of people that are very clearly who is the process model. Patient here, but doing it someone who does what, circular boxes, what information, produce what information, to kind of execute a form of that process that does require that process. Just to kind of bring this back to the big idea that the intuition is like the tools, the stakeholder engagement tools, the design generation tools, the analysis tools, the decision theory, all of that stuff is kind of coming in focus as possible, kind of leveraging it to find in a different way what this project is about and asking. That I'd love to hear any comments or questions. So it's a great question. In some ways, yes, in some ways, no. When working with this kind of relocated classroom problem at one point, we're working in a San Diego environment, and darn if this thing didn't like turn itself to face due west and create this huge window. My intuition told me that the window facing west in San Diego and probably crossing. But then we got kind of into it and tried to understand what's going on. It's like, it's a school. You occupied to 2 p.m. You know, maybe we get all this great daylight in the morning, so we have to light the building even okay if it overheats at night and it's cooling down in the morning because everything. At least that's the way we set up the model. And so it caused us to kind of question our intuition and be more clear and explicit about what it was. So in that sense, I just think our intuitions are constantly being questioned. But there's a whole lot of intuition. Like it's not open up the box, push the button, get out of hospital. It's all of this work and figuring out who are the right people to bring to the table, what are the right objectives to be asking at this point in the decision, what are the interesting alternatives that we're doing. All of that, you know, the iterative and informed by these computer tools, but that's the intuition of why. What's the right way to frame it?
Budget for time for the research? How do you determine how much time the project needs for this kind of research?
Yeah, it's a great question.
What's the question?
The question was, how do you budget the time for research? So I'm going to take this as a somewhat more meta question that's about instruction research, in particular research and practice. And, you know, I'll say we're lucky with the size of the firm we are that we have. We're able to fund some research beyond project budgets. We're very interested in trying to get more research in projects, and ideally funded by projects, as mentioned earlier. We, you know, we do have found the need to have some slack resources to allow us to first research and invest in search beyond the project budget. The project has enormous value to provide to research in the case data and all the experience and often not productive to place the burden of funding all that on the project budget. It'd be great if they do, and we want more smarter clients who are willing to do that. So the first answer, I guess, is question is meta funding question. And then it's also a bit intuitive. It's like a number of pieces need to come together to really make a research project sing. Need good senior leadership, and we're going to clear the path and make sure things happen. Good younger people who actually know how to implement the tools and who actually do the work. In the project that I'm showing here, you need sort of an academic side, So it's when you have enough of those pieces in place, you just kind of go for it. Ask forgiveness rather than permission. That's such a great question, and in a sense, I sort of pitched this a bit of like, the BIM model of one alternative, and that's my rationale model, and then more information around that would help you to get to the decision. I'll probably try to answer the question with a working model around that, to talk about the kind of life of the decision project and the validation. I have written a couple of sort of papers that I've known from friends about choosing my advantage and problems from where the decision model and then spectrum on the machine learning with that, but build a thousand of these models and decide them about whatever it is, legal types or patient or something like that, and all that information should be interesting. Make that decision, it should start to suggest to you which stakeholders you might want to have to take on, which alternatives might be most fruitful. Analysis might be most impactful. The vision is that you can formalize this information with a lot you'd be able to do with it. But first, you have to formalize it.